the second Shiny program we discuss in the course. We will explore many more features of Shiny through this program. Before we get on to the code, let us see a demonstration so that we understand what exactly we'll be discussing in the code. So we give the URL and here we have the application. It is still loading. Now it's loaded. The first thing we will explore is how to create radio buttons in Shiny. Second thing we will explore is how to upload files in Shiny. So we will upload two types of files, text file and PDF file. So when we say text file, we will see that it opens the file explorer, and in this only the text files are shown to us. It does not allow us to select any other type of file other than text files. Now when we select the PDF file, see that it changes to only selection of PDF files. We will see how this we can do, that we can change the characteristic of the input button so that we select a specific type of file only. Now when we say select PDF file, it allows me to select only PDF files. You can see that it shows me all the PDF files which are available for selection. You notice that other type of files are not allowed for selection. So we will see how we can control this. Next, we will see how we can download report from the Shiny program. And now also you see that the download report button is disabled. So we will see how we can enable or disable a particular control in Shiny program. Now we load a PDF file. You notice that the PDF file is loading. Once the loading is completed, it will show us the contents of the file. You see that the display on the right hand side has not changed from that image to the contents of the file. So depending on the network speed, it will take a while, or normally it should be very quick. So this is another aspect we will explore, how we can display the contents of a data set in a table format. So we can browse through the different pages of this data. We can also copy as or download as CSV or Excel. This also provides me the facility to search for a particular data and then download or copy them. Then we come to the word cloud, which is the demonstration. In this word cloud, we will see the slider, how to use the slider. And when we increase or decrease the value in the slider, the display changes. So we will see how to control the output based on another control. And in this case, the control is a slider. So once we have the output, you see that download report button is now enabled. We can download the report. We will see how to generate a message like this, which says wait for a while. Then we can download the report to a specific file. Now this report is created using R Markdown. We have discussed R Markdown, but now we will discuss how to pass parameters into R Markdown so that the same R Markdown can be used to generate different reports under different circumstances. Also notice some few things, like the date now is not hard-coded like we saw in the R Markdown demonstration. It is dynamic. It is changing based on the requirement. We have already studied how to create R Markdown. This program is the same which we have utilized, that we discussed while discussing the R Markdown features. Now we select another PDF file and the display should change based on the new contents of the PDF file. We will see how this can be accomplished in Shiny. We have not done this before. So now you see the display or the contents displayed is different. Also, we will see that how to reset the value of a slider. You notice that the slider has gone back to 50 from where we had set it last time when we were seeing the output. So again, when we download the report, we save it to a different file so that you can see that the contents have changed based on the current state of what we are dealing with. Notice that the word cloud is just the same as what we saw in the display. Now we select a text file. So when we select a text file, the display on the right is again reset. We will see how to do this. And now we select a text file. Notice that it only allows me to select a text file. So I select a text file. Now I am getting the contents of this text file. It is shown here. Now we go to the word cloud. Normally it should not take so much amount of time to generate the default word cloud, but this can be because of network throughput. So there we have it. You once again download this particular report. You open the file. So notice here, we are passing the file name as a parameter. We will see how to do that. So for every report, the file name is different. That is the file we chose for analyzing. That file name is shown here. Also, we are passing the data as a parameter. That's why the word cloud is changing, the top 5 words is changing, etc. Next, we will study the code which is required to generate all this output that we saw in this particular demonstration. We now go through the code that is required to develop the application we just saw in the demonstration. Now there are a lot of things which we can do with Shiny. However, we will see a part of it, and the remaining I would expect that you will explore by yourself. The first aspect that we look at in the code is how to create the radio button. So the code for that is given here. We will explore the parts of this. The output, as you have seen in the demonstration, looks like what is shown here. The first thing we need to notice is the function used to create radio buttons in Shiny. For every control, Shiny provides a function, and you need to find out what is the function for every control that you want to create. Next, as you would recall from our previous discussion on Shiny programming, every control needs to be associated with the variable. Now in this case, we have associated a variable called v_file_type with the radio button. This is given within quotations. For the radio button, we need to provide a label that will be displayed where the radio button is created.
Now in this case, you can see that we have set the label as set file type to upload. Now we have given H3, that means this is made a header 3 and is displayed in a large font. Next, we come to the choices, what needs to be provided to the user through the radio button. The choices are provided as a vector. Now here we have two choices, either to select a text file or a PDF file. Now for each choice, we must have an indicator. In this case, TXT is the indicator for text file and PDF is the indicator for PDF files. However, I have used constants because I will be using these values later in the program as well. The last thing we discuss about the radio button is the way the radio button will be displayed. Now, if you use the parameter inline is equal to true, then the radio buttons will be displayed in the same line. If you say inline is equal to false, then the radio buttons will be placed one below the other. Now, there are other parameters also which can be used in radio button. However, I will leave it to you to explore the same. Now that we have our radio button, let us next see how to input file through a Shiny program. To input the file, we will require to write code on the front end as well as on the back end, that is on the UI as well as on the server. So on the UI part, we have to write this piece of code to upload text files. We will go through the parts of this code individually. As you have seen, the output will look like this. The first thing we need to see is the function required for inputting files in Shiny. So it is file input. Notice the case of the letters so that it is not mistaken. As you all know, we will require a variable in which we will store the name of the file that is input. So in our case, it is v_input_file_txt. We have to give a label so that it indicates that we have to upload a file. So we can give a label. The label can be a plain text or it can be a HTML text like I have done here, or I can also make it dynamic by using functions like paste. In this case, I have said multiple is equal to false. That means I can only input one file at a time. If I say multiple is equal to true, I can input more than one file at a time. The placeholder parameter. Now this text is displayed on the control when there is no file selected, as you can see in the display. So whatever I give in the placeholder is displayed while there is no file provided. Last parameter is what is the type of file we want to input. So here we have given that we can input text files only and comma separated files. So now this is the MIME type checker. If you give this command, then it will check the MIME type and only ensure that text files are accepted. When we have to accept PDF files, we can change the MIME type as it is given here. Now let's take a look at what we need to do on the server side for uploading files. We have got the file name by browsing through the Finder in Apple Mac or through the File Explorer in Windows through the UI code. Now we need to read the file and get its data. So the code is given here. We will go through each part of it one by one and understand. This code will read the file, convert the contents into a data frame, and then clean it, and then determine the word frequency from the text that is read from this file. We need to understand the nuances, so let's go through one by one. To read the file, we require the function readLines. readLines takes the path from where the file has to be read. readLines is available in the library readR. So we have to include this library in our program. Now we have to pass the path from where the file will be read. So to provide the input path, we need to provide the variable input. This is applicable for all the variables that is input from the UI of the Shiny program. Under input, we had specified that the file name for the text file will be available in v_input_file_txt. So we have to give that variable which has captured the file name as it has been captured by the control. Next, under that variable, we have to provide the variable data path. This parameter of v_input_file_text contains the path of the file from where the data has to be read. readLine reads the file and stores the contents in a vector. Each line of the file is an element of this vector. So we treat the elements one by one next. After reading the file, we remove the special characters from each element of the vector by using regular expressions, and then we create a data frame using the function table. In this data frame, we will have one column called text. We store the output of this complete command in the variable v_text. So v_text now is a data frame which contains all the lines of the file that has been read. Next, in the data frame that we have just created, v_text, we remove the empty lines. For this, we need the function dropEmptyRow, and this is available in the library textClean. To the function dropEmptyRow, we pass the data frame v_text and store the output in a data frame v_rawText. Next, we use a function to calculate the word frequency. We have gone through this while we are discussing R Markdown, but anyway, we will have another look at it shortly. So the output of this calculate word frequency function is a data frame which contains the words and the frequency of the words, which we will store in a data frame called v_df. So we assign the output of the calculate word frequency function in the data frame v_df. Now you need to look at the fact that we have used a function called reactive. A reactive is used so that the contents of the Shiny program changes as and when we have a change in the file name in this particular case. So a reactive expression is a R expression that uses the widget input and returns a value. The reactive expression will update this value whenever the original widget changes. The original widget in our case is the file name, that is v_input_file_txt. Now we see how to read the PDF file and use its contents for analysis. For reading PDF files, we will use the function pdftext. This is found in the library pdftools. Now to the function pdftext, we have to pass the file path just like we had done for the text file. The function pdf_text returns the contents of a file as a single element. So what we have to do is to separate each line of the input text into separate elements. For that we require the function strsplit. Now we will use the function strsplit to split based on the new line character. Now to do that, we have to pipe the contents of the function pdf_text to the function strsplit. So you can see the pipe operator. This is found in the library dplyr. The output of this complete operation is stored in the data frame v_raw_text. So v_raw_text will be a data frame containing each line of the file as a separate element. So far we have seen how we can place a radio button and also how we can place a file input. In our case, we saw how we can make a file input for text file and for PDF file. Now, as per the requirement of our program, we need to either input a text file or a PDF file based on the type of file that is selected. So, only one of the two controls, either PDF file input or text file input, should be active at any point of time. We have to hide or show the controls based on the selection. Now, to do this, we can use the library ShinyJS. Now, for using ShinyJS, we need to write code on the UI as well as on the server side. Now, in the UI, we need to write the statement here immediately after the UI is declared, where we say that ShinyJS :: use ShinyJS function. This statement makes it possible for the Shiny program to use ShinyJS library. Please remember that unless this statement is used in the program, the ShinyJS will not work in the Shiny program. Now that ShinyJS has been invoked, we can make use of it. So, for making use of it, we need to write server-side code. So, in the server side, what we want to code is that when text file input is selected, then we must show the file input for text file, and when PDF file input is selected, we must show the file input for PDF file. So we can achieve it through the code which is given here. We will discuss this code next. We can hide a control or a widget, as it is called in Shiny, by using the function ShinyJS:hide. We have to pass the ID of the control or widget to this function. Similarly, we can show a widget or a control by using the function ShinyJS:show. We have to pass the ID of the control here as well. Now, in our case, based on the file type, we have to either show the file input for text file or the file input for PDF file. So what we do is, when the file type is text file, we hide the PDF file input and show the text file input, and we do the reverse if the file type is PDF file. Now, observe that we have to use a function called observe. Now, observe observes the variable v_file_type. Whenever there's a change in this variable, the controls are updated, whether they'll be shown or hidden. Now, the observer is like a reactive expression, in that it can read a reactive value or call a reactive expression and will automatically re-execute when the dependencies change. But unlike a reactive expression, it does not give back a return value. We will see more use of observe in our program down the line. Now let us see how we can plant a slider in our Shiny program. As you would have seen in the demonstration, we require the slider to set the number of words that we want to display in the word cloud. So let us see how we can put the slider. Now, to plant the slider, we require the code as it is shown here. We will go through each part of it in details. The output of this code will look like what is shown at the bottom of the screen. As always, first we take a look at the function in Shiny which is required to create a slider. So in this case, it is slider input. Notice the case of the letters in the function name. Next, we need a variable using which we can control the slider. So in our case, the variable name is v_number_of_words_pdf. This is the slider we will use for controlling the number of words in the word cloud when the input file is a PDF file. The next parameter for the slider input function is a label which we can set, which will be displayed on top of the slider to indicate what has to be done with the slider. The label can be a plain text or HTML text as I have used here. So I have set the label as set number of words to display. The next two parameters are to set the minimum value of the slider and the maximum value of the slider. Look at the slider example below, you can see that it is set to 20 as minimum and 500 as maximum. The next parameter is to set the default value when the slider is first displayed in the program. Now this has to be a number. I have used a constant here because we will use this number later in the program once again. The last set of parameters we discuss for slider input function is step and ticks. Now step is the amount by which the slider will increment or decrement each time it is used. And the tick is whether to show the ticks or not to show the ticks. Now that we have our slider, let us do some operations on the slider. In the demonstration, we saw that when we change the file, which has to be analyzed, the slider is reset back to display only 50 words in the word cloud. Let us find out how we can achieve this operation. To achieve this, we require the following code in the server side. We will study this code in more details. The first thing to notice is that we have used the function observeEvent. Now observeEvent observes the variable v_input_file_pdf. So when the file in the variable v_input_file_pdf is changed, the observe event will fire and execute the code within its body. So now we have the technique as to when to reset the slider. Next, let us reset the slider to the default value when the file is changed. To do this, we require the function updateSliderInput. Now we need to pass the session. We need to pass the variable which represents the slider, and then we can change any value of the slider, which is a property of the slider. Here we want to set the default value, so we will set the variable value to a value which is stored as a constant in the program. As I just mentioned, using updateSliderInput function, we can set the value for any of the properties of the slider. Now let us see how we will use our slider. We know that we will use the slider to set the number of words that we will display in the word cloud. So this is the code which generates the word cloud. You notice that we have used a function called generateWordCloud to which we pass the slider value of what is the number of words to display. Now we use the same function generateWordCloud to display the word cloud for text file input and PDF file input. So generating the word cloud is the same for both cases, only the number of words comes from a different variable. When it is a PDF file, the variable is v_number_of_words_PDF, and when it is text file, it is v_number_of_words_TXT. So I'm highlighting the code where we are passing the number of words as is generated by the slider to the function generateWordCloud. You can see that in the generateWordCloud function, we have set max words is equal to the number of words passed from the slider. We will now explore the remaining part of the code. To display the word cloud, we need to render a plot. So we use the function renderPlot. We need a different variable for WordCloudPDF for the PDF file WordCloud, and we require a variable WordCloudTXT for the WordCloud for text files. We have used the rec function in our function. The rec function stands for required. This ensures that the variable v_input_file_pdf definitely has a value. If it does not have a value, the function stops here. If it has a value, the function proceeds. Lastly, we can display a message while the word cloud is getting generated. This can keep the user engaged. This can be done with withProgress function. So we need to pass a message. This will appear as a dialogue, and in the dialogue we'll have a header called generating and a message called this may take a while. In the demonstration, we saw that when we select a file, we show the analysis of the file, that is the word cloud and the data we extracted from the file in tabs. So next, let's see how to create these tabs. There's a fair bit of code that we will discuss now. We will discuss code both on the front end as well as on the back end, that is in the UI as well as in the server. We will also discuss some nuances which is specifically required in Shiny programming. So let's get started. The first thing we need to do to create tabs is to create the tab set. So we need to use the function tab set panel in which we have to create the tabs. The tab set panel has an ID and we can say type is equal to tabs. Inside the tab set panel, we can create each tab. To create a tab, we need to use the function tab panel as it is shown here. So we have got two tab panels, one we called data, one we called word cloud. In the data tab, we will show the data, that is the frequency of the words, and in the word cloud tab, we will show the word cloud. Inside the tab panel, we put the code for what we want the contents to be inside the tab. So here we have two tabs. In the first tab, which is data, we put a header, word frequency, and then we put a data table where we display the contents of the file that we have just read. In the word cloud tab, we display a slider through which we will control the number of words that will be displayed in the word cloud, and then we plot the word cloud itself. The code we have discussed so far is enough for creating tabs. However, we will add another bit of the code here where we'll enclose the entire tab set within a div directive. Now, this is required because we want to also hide and show the tab set based on conditions. Using Shiny.js, we can hide or show a div, but we cannot do the same for a tab set panel or a tab panel. So let's see what we have programmed as a whole with respect to tabs in our current program which we have demonstrated. Now, first we have a div in which we display a picture. This is a dummy. Then we have a div where we display the output from a PDF file that we have read. And lastly, we have a div from which we display the output from the text file that we have read. Our purpose is that only one of these divs should be visible at any point of time. When no file is selected, then dummy display should be active. When PDF file is selected, the PDF tab should be active, and when text file is selected, text file tab should be active. I have shown you in this code one way of achieving this particular thing. There can be many other ways in which the same objective can be met. You can try and explore the same yourself. I would encourage you to check conditional panels in Shiny. It's a very powerful feature. You can try it out, check the documentation and see how to use conditional panels. Now let us see what we have to do on the server side. On the server side, we check if the input file PDF or the input file text is empty or null, then we show the dummy display and hide the PDF output and the text output. We do the reverse with more conditions in the opposite case when there is a file selected. I would request you to go through the code which I have attached along with the course and check for yourself what are the other things which we do while the input file has been provided. We saw that in the data tab, we were displaying the words and their frequencies in a data table. So let us see how this was achieved. So the UI code is given here. The variable we have used is PDF contents. Similarly, we have for text contents for the contents of the TXT file. Now on the server side, we require a bit of code. Let us discuss that. So our variable was PDF contents. So we say output $PDF contents and we say render data table. Then we use a function called display data table, and inside that function we use DT colon colon data table. This is got from the library DT. To this function, we pass the data frame in which the data is contained. Then this function takes care of displaying the output that we just saw in the previous slide. Now you can explore the rest of the options of this particular function. It's very powerful and it can do a lot of things for you. The last thing we discuss in this video is how to create and download reports from a Shiny program. Now we require both UI code and the server code for this. The download button on the demonstration you would have seen looks like as it is shown here. Now on this UI, we require to use the function download button. We need to give a variable, that is here we have said report, and then we can give a text which will appear on the button where we have said download report. Now let's see the server side code, which is more intense. On the server side, we need to program an output variable. We had named our variable as report in the UI, so we need to say output $report and then have the following code, which is the download handler. We will go through this code in some details. So the first thing you notice is that we have to program a function called download handler. So for the output $report, we need to say a download handler, which is to be programmed. Inside the download handler, the first thing we do is we declare a variable called file name. Now this variable will contain a value, a string, which will be the default file name when we try to do the download. Of course, the user can change the file name while downloading. Next, we need to write a function to create the contents. To create the contents, we will make use of R Markdown. We will see that we will pass parameters to this R Markdown and then create the output report. So first, we need to create the parameters, what we need to pass to the R Markdown. In my case, I will be passing three parameters: the input file name, the number of words to display, and the data frame containing the word frequency. There is a bit of the code which is not displayed here, so let us discuss it. Now you see that I have used a variable L underscore file underscore name, which is being passed as the parameter for the input file. Now this file name will be either input dollar V underscore file underscore name underscore PDF in case the file type selected is PDF, or V underscore file underscore name underscore TXT in case the file type selected is TXT. Similarly, the number of words to display will come from the slider variable. In case it is PDF file, the PDF sliders variable will be used, or in case it is text file, the text files slider variable will be utilized. You notice that we have said V underscore DF and then open and close bracket. That is because V underscore DF is a function. It became a function because we use reactive so that the contents change as and when the parameters are changed. After having formed the parameters, we invoke the arg markdown. The arg markdown file in our case is called shabdmake.rmd. So we have to invoke this file. This file should exist and contain all the markdown that we want the report to contain. Now to this we pass the output file and we pass the parameters and we pass the environment. Next we will see what the R markdown looks like so that we can understand how the parameters are passed and used. We have studied in details how to create a R markdown, so we will only see the change, what happens to the R markdown when parameters are passed. So now let's see the R markdown code which changes due to the passing of the parameters. So in the YAML on the top, we need to now pass the parameters. It is under the section params. So here we are passing three parameters, so we should input three parameters here as well. So the three parameters are here. So now we don't need to compute the word frequency because the word frequency is already being sent as a parameter. Since the word frequency is already being sent, we also don't need to open a file or read a file from the local directory because the file is already been opened in the Shiny program and that will be the one which will be used as well. So now we just pass the name of the file as a string . We pass the data frame which contains the word frequency. So this is already computed while we were in the Shiny program. So when you opened the file in Shiny, it computed the word frequency. The same has been passed here, so it can be utilized. And we pass a third parameter, which is an integer. This contains the number of words to display in the word cloud. So we can use the same number while generating the word cloud in the R markdown file. So in the R markdown file that we discussed earlier, we need to remove all the code which contains functions for reading a file, computing the word frequency, etc., and just utilize these variables and get the job done. So after this marathon session, we have come to the end of this video. I have attached the complete code along with the lecture in the course. So you can study it and you can look at ways to improve it. Thank you for listening.